IT Idiots would like to thank UK2.net for sponsoring the show, the UK's largest provider of web hosting, providing the content and bandwidth distribution for this show.
Welcome to IT Idiots, episode 20...
Is it 5?
It's only 5, isn't it?
It is?
Yeah. It's exciting. Who do you thought we got there, eh?
Me.
Did you? Really?
I did. Okay. I had every faith in us.
Well, I kind of thought that if we were going to start this thing, it'd look a bit embarrassing if we only did a couple of episodes and then sort of bowed out of it.
And by keep on going, I suppose it gives the impression that we're really popular, doesn't it? And we're really established.
Yeah, I'd like to think so. Mm. So, obviously, we're not wearing the same items that we wore last week.
No, we didn't just record last week's podcast an hour ago.
That's outrageous. Anyone who suggested that, I would almost possibly
sue. No, this is live. This is the webcast. Yeah.
I haven't heard from Samsung since...
Since, what, 2 hours ago?
Yeah.
Or last week.
Last week. Yeah. Ruining the illusion.
So the camcorder's too... How did it go last week then?
Beautiful. Okay. I reckon last week's episode beautifully.
And the downloads were good, were they?
Massive.
Massive, were they?
And I got a lot of good feedback from the widescreen.
When did you manage to release last week's then?
During the week.
What particular day? Any particular day?
I can't remember. I uploaded it. Okay. You're the one who took care of releasing it. What day did you release it on?
Oh, well, I updated the RSS. I was delayed.
I think it was Monday.
Hopefully Monday.
I think you did it on Monday. Okay. I can't remember.
Anyway.
Right, so nothing glittering. So this week's episode is looking quite exciting. Well, at the moment it does. Who knows where it's going to take us. What are we going to do? We're going to be migrating to Exchange 2007.
Yeah, so I think we mentioned it last week. We're going to start looking at some new technology. So I thought it would be a good time to start with Exchange 2007. And also it's publicly available as a beta. So... That sounds like a good idea to me.
Now, obviously, I've got an important role in this.
Yeah, so I haven't done this before. I really don't have much of an idea of Exchange 2007.
I'm on hand.
So this is
going to
be a learning thing as we go. But I think it's going to be kind of easy. I mean, Nick's done a little bit of searching on migrating. And we are actually going to try and migrate from our Exchange 2003 installation. Yeah. So we're back on the IT Idiots network, which is a network we've set up over a few podcasts now. So if you haven't seen those, it's basically... a pretend network. We've got a domain controller in there, we've got SMS in that, and we've got Exchange 2003 in that.
And it all runs on Mac hardware.
It all runs on VMware that's running on Windows XP, which is running on a Mac.
Under boot camp,
yeah. And I'm using on a Mac Mini over there, and I'm using a Mac which is in boot camp as well, actually running XP.
We don't like to do things the easy way.
No, but I just found that the Mac, although, you know, it's cheap, is better performing than my desktop machine.
Yeah, it's depressing, isn't it? Well, no, it's not depressing, it's great.
Because, I mean, I'm running out of power on that thing. I either upgrade it or buy another one, because they're £400 now.
Aren't they? Well, the new ones, are they the dual 2-core?
No, not just yet. Mind you, I think there's a lot of fuss over that, because everyone at work's talking about the Core 2 Duo and you should wait for it. But I've read plenty of articles that say you only get a 7% increase in speed. So although
it makes me feel happier about buying my iMac.
Oh, you didn't get the... Oh, no, they're really good. I mean, I feel gutted for people who bought it just before it came. I did as well, didn't I? Never mind.
That's us. We feel gutted for ourselves.
Anyway, Exchange again. So it's all up and running. And, of course, we've been using it thoroughly, and it's got lots of really important emails in there.
And some pretty important users.
So it's not an option for us to do a clean install. So what we're going to investigate is doing a migration to Exchange.
We wanted to make life difficult for ourselves.
Exactly. So I've downloaded the beta, and let me just go to...
We really must stress here that we have not touched this product other than installing the prerequisites.
Yeah, we've done about 2 minutes of reading as well, haven't we?
Well, I read somebody's blog.
Okay.
And they told us that we haven't got enough memory to run it.
Yeah, that might be a bit of a problem, actually, but hopefully...
But hey, we're installing it, we're not running it.
Yeah. So here's the installation routine. Already you can see the first three steps have been completed, and the first one was install .NET framework, second one was install the new MMC, so MMC version 3, and the next one was installing the command shell, which is something we really ought to have a look at. It's like the new command prompt. It's like Unix shells,
cool.
Bash shells and stuff. So, that's going to be very, very prevalent in upcoming products as well. So they're all installed and released. It was really piss easy to install them. It was really easy to install them. It was just next all the way through. And the nice thing about the installation program, first of all, is it did link to them all. So it's very, very easy to install.
So no need for a consultant to this point, then?
No need for a consultancy for this point as well.
Okay.
Now, the way we're going to migrate is we've got the Exchange 2003 server running in the domain, and we're going to migrate all the mailboxes across to Exchange 2007. Now, we've done a little bit of reading, and it looks very similar to the way you migrate 2000 to 2003 and 5.5, etc.
So have we prepped everything and everything?
We've done a little bit of preparation, but we might come across a few errors. So the plan is to install Exchange 2007 beta into our existing organization, and then move the mailboxes from 2003 over to 2007,
yep.
And then we can decommission the 2003 box.
And I think during the process, Active Directory will get prepped for us.
It certainly will. It will get updated.
Just from my experience.
Just from your experience. Yeah.
It's what I would expect from this product.
Yeah, I think it does a schema update on it as well.
Yeah.
One thing I'm slightly worried about is
install.
You know, at work, I'm not actually in the Exchange team at work. I'm in the system management team, and they've been talking about the many roles that Exchange has got. Like, it's got a mailbox role, an edge transfer role, and all of these.
I feel a get-out clause coming here, ladies.
And they're saying that it might... I got the impression that some of them were telling me it needs to run on multiple machines.
Ah.
So I'm not sure about that.
So we might need to buy another Mac.
We might need to pop up another virtual machine. So I'm just going to go through step four, which is just click on the installation of Exchange. Now, the install routine, we did take it this far because we didn't want to, you know,
bore you.
Get to a point and realise we couldn't go any further. And one thing I did notice is it was really nice. It did analyse my system prior to the installation.
It did, yeah, I thought that was quite impressive.
And it said, well, I tried to do a little prep, and based on my 2003 knowledge, I put NMTP and SMTP on it because you need those.
Yeah.
So as soon as I clicked on the install in 2007, it said, oh, you can't have those, you need to remove them. So I'm not quite sure how messaging is going to work, whether it's going to install its own SMTP transport or not, but we should have a look.
Hey.
Maybe it's a new version or something.
This is half the fun.
The other thing, just to notice why it's taking some time here, is Exchange 2007, I believe it's only going to be available in 64-bit versions.
Yeah, but they're allowing a 32-bit version as a taster, is it?
As a taster, so people can test it and trial it. And okay. So I think that's just about the amount of memory it needs, really.
So when they release the final version, how are we going to be introducing this into our domain now that we've led on to people that we don't actually have a server room?
I don't know, maybe someone will give us one.
Yeah, I mean, that is 60-bit? 64-bit? Are they expensive for a 64-bit server now?
I don't know. Nah, they're all 64-bit now.
Can we get one from Advent on the cheap?
PC World.
I'm telling you, by the time I finish with Samsung, they'll be begging to give us servers.
God, this is taking longer than it did when we went for the little trial run.
What little trial run? We just told everybody that we haven't touched it.
No, we took it this far.
We did?
We took it to the next stage. Because it hasn't done the analysis yet.
We didn't tell them we'd taken it to the next stage.
Well, I did, because we talked about the fact that it told us we needed SMTP in it. Are you paying attention?
But they were assuming, probably, that was earlier on.
Jesus.
So this is all looking quite exciting.
It is, isn't it?
Oh, here we go.
Okay, so introduction. I'm going to quickly skip through that, because that doesn't look very exciting. And the standard license agreement, we all know all about that.
Preamble.
And error reporting. Do you want to send any error reports across to Microsoft? Again, I'm not going to do that, because I don't want to use my internet connection. Right, so I can go for a typical Exchange server installation, and or a custom Exchange server installation. Now, up the top here, the typical Exchange server installation, these are the roles I was talking about, Nick.
Yeah.
You've got hub transport role, client access role, mailbox role, and Exchange management tool. So presumably that's enough roles to run a typical Exchange server. But if you look down here, I'm just going to go into custom.
Oh, God.
And click on next.
To the edge. Is that like leading edge?
This is a nice screen. It tells you what the roles actually do. So it looks like the mailbox role profiles email storage and service for Outlook users.
Okay.
Also includes public folders. Client access role, it looks like it allows you to have Outlook web access pop or IMAP. So it looks like it's a front-end server, really. Hub transport role provides routing within a secure Active Directory site.
Sounds good to me.
Oh, no, it's got anti-spam and antivirus policies.
Oh, you're right, built into it. Oh, that's quite cool.
Or is that like plugins? An edge server? Oh, no, there's an edge transport role there as well.
What does that do? Oh, that's performs anti-spam.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Well, maybe I suppose you get a hub transport within an organisation.
Sure.
For spamming in that one. Unified message role provides connectivity between telephone systems and stuff. Cool. I don't want to do that.
No. Oh, just whilst we're talking about Exchange, remember when I told you that on my Exchange server I had to use DNS to send out mail?
Uh-huh.
I found a distinct downside to that.
It must have more performance hit.
No, not that. I mean, we don't send out that much. It's just about everybody, like AOL, and everyone says, "Now bollocks to you, you're a spammer."
Really?
Yeah. So I ended up having to, on my web server, create my own mail server, and then I connect to that, and then because it was a mail server that could be verified.
Right.
You know, back to IT
idiots. Oh, of course, because you're behind that, aren't you?
Yeah,
so it couldn't verify. You could probably sort that with a rule,
but anyway, I don't have the intelligence
for that.
No, but I thought I was pretty good in...
No, that was the problem.
And then finding a solution for that problem.
Well done.
Why, thank you for patronising me.
Well, it looks like we've got some cluster roles here, so we can do active-passive clustering. It might be an easy way to install it. And management tools, I guess, for, you know, your local client machine.
Right.
Okay, so I'm going to go back on there and go for a typical install, I think, on that.
Just imagine there's a team that probably just designs all this install stuff.
That's kind of nice, doesn't it?
It does.
Right, to enable message flow to Exchange 2000, a routing group connector is required. Select an Exchange 2000 or 2000 server in the routing group.
Well, we've got one of those.
It's connect.
Yeah.
So if I click on browse, it's seen my Exchange organisation, which is quite nice.
Beautiful.
I suppose
that's really nice.
AD query. And I just select my existing Exchange server and click on next. Right, here's the prerequisite check that we talked about earlier. So we did get this far, but we didn't go much further than this.
Did we?
Yeah, and this is where it's telling us that NMTP was installed, and SMTP.
I wasn't aware that it had done that at that point, because I thought it couldn't connect to the server or something.
No, it got that far.
It did, yeah. Okay. So I apologise, I was ignoring him earlier on in the 3 hours it's taken him to get to this point.
Used to it.
I noticed we got some great feedback on the podcast I did last week.
Did we?
Yeah.
Can you see in the future then, can you?
You can't keep up the illusion, can you?
No, people like you for some reason.
Like,
I think it's pity. Your Gymna episode went down quite well.
Yeah, I think it's just nobody likes a smart ass, and everyone wants to, you know.
Yeah,
they don't appreciate that you're not really, an arsehole.
I know, I just got this strange...
It's like shabby clams up, you just turn into an arsehole.
An arrogant git, don't I?
I just seem to be the only one who can naturally carry off being in front of the camera.
Right, so it looks like everything's okay. It says 32-bit version of Exchange isn't supported for production use. And it can't verify that the host record exists in DNS. Now, I had a quick look at DNS, and it is in there.
Yeah.
Quite why it can't verify, I don't know.
Who cares?
Who cares, so just click on install.
Hey, look, we've got idiots in the title. We're allowed to say who cares. I feel we are the Family Guy of IT.
Yeah.
Ground floor perfumery, stationery and leather goods, wigs and haberdashery, kitchenware and food. First floor, telephones, gents, ready-made suits, shirts, socks, high hats, underwear and shoes. Second floor, carpets, travel goods and bedding.
Preparation, it's copied Exchange files. That was really exciting. And it's copied the hub transfer files. That was equally as exciting.
For me, it was the hub transfer.
They all seem to be the same. They sort of start off and this thing progresses from left to right. Yeah, it gets more blue. So that's meant to be an indication.
And I think the more blue, the better.
Yeah. So we can see here, this one's not so bluer.
See, have you noticed though, on times, for me, I found 305 to be inspirational and a modern approach.
It was good. And that one, 247, it was just a little bit too snappy, wasn't it?
And did you find that the 828 was just a little bit too predictable?
It was
predictable.
Yeah, exactly.
It was a nothingness for me.
So timings, you know, they got the timings all wrong, I feel.
In 1972, a crack commando unit was sent to prison by a military court for a crime they didn't commit. These men promptly escaped from a maximum security stockade to the Los Angeles underground. Today, still wanted by the government, they survive as soldiers of fortune. If you have a problem, if no one else can help, and if you can find them, maybe you can hire the A-Team.
Okay, so we're back, and Exchange server is done. That's pretty
much it. Okay, looks like we can copy the contents of this, which is always a good idea.
I guess just building up a log of everything that's been going on. I guess it allows you to present a document, maybe to your boss, that shows that everything did go according to plan and you weren't cutting any corners and ignoring things. And
exactly, and sometimes like the Exchange logs as well, I always take installation logs with you, always take backups of those, because sometimes the installation does work and it gives the appearance that it works, and sometimes you get a little error in the log file which explains something that might happen 3 months down the line.
Okay. You know, so you've actually experienced that? Or just theory?
Just theory. No, installation logs I always take with me anyway because they form part of the installed documentation.
Yeah, but your clients probably never have any problems after you've finished doing your job anyway.
Well, not with me, obviously. That's apart from when I move Exchange groups. Yeah, that's not a good idea.
But you were just testing to see whether they knew what they
exactly
were doing.
Exactly. I was checking the response time. I mean, the call came in, it was solved instantly. Well done, too.
Testing yourself.
Exactly.
Who took the call?
One of the support guys.
Did he know what he was doing or did he have to escalate it?
No, he got it. He Google searched it, just like the rest of the IT world do.
That's fair enough.
Why am I saving this as a log? It's not really I imagine there being an installation.
Delete me.txt.
Yeah. I don't know where I saved it. Right, finish. Right, we got it. And what do we do now? So I don't know what it's done. It hasn't asked me for an Exchange organisation.
Mm.
It hasn't asked me whether I need to create one, join an existing one, which I'm used to with the previous versions of Exchange. But it did ask me what an Exchange server was, you know, an existing one.
Okay, did you install Office like I instructed you to do?
Office is currently installing.
Okay.
Hence the noise from coming over there.
Do you want to come back to me when the job's done?
No, I think we can explore now.
Yeah, I know, but as your boss, I mean, I don't really need to be in the hands-on role, do I?
Oh, look, it's doing...
Adding the snap in, preparing to delete.
I noticed this is a new MMC console, because I was playing around with the SMS version 4, and that required the new MMC console. Basically, it seems to be that every time you load it in MMC, you get this animation, yeah.
So. Not really so much an animation. I don't think it's animation in Apple's
just
terms.
It's just annoying, yeah. I've seen the new Apple adverts.
Yeah, you showed them to me today.
I know, I'm generating bloody chit-chat, aren't I?
Yeah, I watched them Christ. During the week, because obviously they only just came out last weekend, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, look, I can get critical updates. I suppose it's asked me to do that now.
Look, this is good. They're getting into the realms of... I mean, do you remember
Well, it
the
would
early
be good
days?
If you sync that up properly, because otherwise they say this is good and I'm looking at another console.
But, okay.
Right, okay, look, we've got Hub Transport, we can verify deployment.
I try my best.
I've installed configured domain switch, you accept email. What? Subscribe. What? I don't understand. Right, action. Options. That's obviously something else. I'm just seeing if there's any properties of the Exchange organisation. Mailbox.
Excellent.
So it's found
hubs.
It's got the first storage group. I'm interested to see.
Is it doing anything in the background here, or has it done it all?
I think it's finished it all, but I don't know how it's connected to the other Exchange servers or what exactly I've done here.
Okay.
Your Exchange organisation has no servers within.
So the next
organisation configuration. Let's have a look under here.
Okay, but the next stage has surely got to be to deprecate. Our 2003 server, because surely it's
well,
worked.
Yeah, exactly.
Surely it's just worked.
I'm sure it has, but I don't...
No. Let's have a look at some of the users. Just have a look at some of the users.
Oh, it's tabbed up here.
Yeah.
I'm going to go to organisation. Oh,
that
exactly.
One's not.
So that's obviously a permissions one. Manage default folders. Looks like you've got a bit of control over Outlook. But client access.
But I want to see the client boxes. Mailbox.
Yeah, I think a lot of the... administration happens now from Active Directory, users and computers.
Oh, right, okay, we don't have to go into Exchange to do anything anymore.
Well, no, I think you still do, but I think a lot of it can happen from...
The shell.
No, not the shell.
But that's what we're at.
I'm just randomly running stuff at the moment. Ah. Did you notice that? I just ran up the shell. Tip of the day, do you want to move mailboxes? Yeah, I do.
Cool. So you didn't think it would actually... Okay. So
no, this is just giving me a script hint.
Right, so let's do move-mailbox. Type. It's telling you, do type move-mailbox.
I don't think this is going to work, because I don't... But moving from
you can move all users from server 1 to server 2 as follows. Get dash, that's the one you want.
Get mailbox. I just can't see this working. Right, IHQEXE.
No, it's server.
Oh, yeah. Server IHQ. Do I have to rename my server?
No, you see, you didn't type in SRV1 there.
And then it wants a pipe.
Uh-oh.
Where's the pipe?
There?
No.
There. E. E. Move, dash, mailbox, space, space, dash, target.
SRV2.
No.
IHQ.
No, you don't want a dash either. There's no dash in the name of your server.
Shut up. Who's the certified professional here?
That's what I really wonder.
Right, IHQ EX2K7.
Yeah.
This ain't going to work, mate.
Of course it will. There you go, I can hear it working. Sort of.
Parameters cannot be processed because the parameter name target is ambiguous. What?
What have you typed in incorrectly? We've all spotted it.
Have you?
Yeah, we're all sat here having spotted
where?
It.
Move dash mailbox minus target. You haven't, have you?
Oh, I have.
Seriously?
Yeah, look at the way the piping is. You're trying to move that into that, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm getting the mailbox.
Yeah.
Of IHQEXCO1, and I'm moving it into the target. Yeah?
Okay, you think about it some more.
You tell me what's different.
I was hoping you were going to figure it out and then go, ah, <"Ha-ha." laughs> Damn you to hell, Curtin.
I'm not convinced that this is installed into the Exchange organisation. What I'm going to do is I'm going to have a look at the Exchange 2000, see what that reckons, or 2003.
Okay, I'm just going to fire up.
And go to System Manager.
You asked me to do
and
some...
go to Servers. And it's only going to show me one freaking server, I just know it. Yeah.
Well, so add it in. Add it to the domain. Have you added it in?
Well, normally you do it during installation.
What, did you? Do you remember to?
I think this Exchange 2007 needs some work on it. So, we come back and I suppose we're sort of confused a little bit, weren't we? Because we installed Exchange 2007 and it didn't go like 2003. I suppose we should have read the help, but that's not really the point of this podcast.
So, what you actually did was you went away and read the help.
Yeah, I just looked at the online help here and to be honest, I didn't do any modifications. I'm just really confused on how it picked up the Exchange organisation it didn't ask me to join. But just one thing I did at the top, just go to Organisation Configuration, just modified the configuration here and set a domain controller where it's going to store its information from.
Okay, it didn't have that. That wasn't already set up.
I was quite surprised it didn't pick that one up. I don't know, maybe...
I would have thought that would have prompted you for that.
Not surprised. And when I go to Mailbox here, I can see... I've got a couple of mailboxes from Exchange 2003 in there, so I've got Shabby and Administrator.
Wait,
in there.
Where are the other 20,000
legacy mailboxes? Oh, I tidied them up prior to the migration.
Oh, okay.
I didn't want
to. Is that a fairly standard practice thing?
Yeah,
to do?
I think it is. What I'm going to do actually, because I think I just want to show. Well, I just want to explore a little bit. So what I'm going to do is in Exchange 2003, I'm going to create a new mailbox here
through Active Directory.
Yeah, and then see if that shows up and if I can move that to.
I mean, we've got to apologise here at this point.
No, this is reasonable.
Let me apologise. You know, Shabby was the one who had done all the research on this. He was meant to come and actually do this, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He was going to be hosting this podcast, but he backed out at the last minute when he realised it was going to involve a computer. I mean, last weekend he was all sort of, yeah, I can do the migration. Bib.
Bob. I probably got a Bob, I imagine. Yeah. Bob 2.
Oh, I remember when we created Bob 2, actually. Oh, those were the great days of podcasting. Now everyone's doing it.
Oh, no. 25, you know. 25 episodes.
I know.
Password matches.
It does now when you type both of them.
Right, this is going to be interesting. So I can install it on an Exchange admin group. So, okay.
Oh, wow.
So
okay.
I think it's put another admin group with another Exchange server on there, perhaps, but... Well, if you look, this is IHQ. So it has joined it to the organisation. What I'm going to do is just put it on EXCO1 there.
Why?
Just so I can move another mailbox.
Oh, you're going to actually try shift-migrating one?
Yeah.
I do this via the internet to my server and it runs quicker than this. I think that's needing another gig of RAM.
I think it might be, yeah.
I mean, it seems a bit outrageous to me that you can't run two exchanges, a domain controller, and possibly SMS on one Mac Mini. In virtualization. Oh, look at that.
Right. So, just playing around really, let's go back to Exchange 2007.
Okay, so what Nicky's doing here is switching between two...
it's just two RDP sessions. Right, let's go back to mailbox, refresh here.
What are you hoping for?
I'm hoping to see Bob, to be honest.
Yeah, are you convinced that it's going to automatically sort of replicate between...
That information is stored in the config partition of Active Directory, and this is pointing to it.
Of course, So, if you'd created this on this machine, it wouldn't probably come up as a legacy mailbox.
I'm sure. Right, so let's move mailbox.
What, shabby?
Shabby, yeah.
Okay.
Sweet. So it's kind of painful, so we're moving it to Exchange Server 2007.
You think that's painful?
Did I say painful?
Painless. Yeah, painless, I think is what you were really, obviously, until we spend the next 3 hours trying to...
Mailbox database, right.
Next,
I can just about get to. Right, specify we'd like to handle corrupted messages. Skip the corrupted messages.
Probably he's got any messages, has he?
Nah. Move schedule. Oh, so you can schedule it. That's one thing that's when nice. I was doing mail migrations from 5.5 to 2000, you can't schedule the thing.
So you'd have to be there at the hour that it needs to run.
Kick it off at like Saturday night or Friday night and then come back the next morning.
Yeah, but it means that you still have users, for example, working till quite late on a Friday night.
Yeah, it's true.
So what a nightmare.
Well, normally, I think with mail migrations, you've got to expect a little bit of downtime, because it's moving data from one place to another.
Yeah.
There's no way the client can deal with that.
No, but it'd be nice to be able to schedule that for, say, Saturday, between Saturday and Sunday, early morning. Minimum impact. Okay.
So it's moving that
Only
across.
30 seconds to move across. No emails for Shabby. Closing connect. I guess it's all opening connections.
Well, there might be someone's in there.
Bad items, none. How great
bad
is that?
Items, so that looks pretty cool. So let's finish on that. So we can see the mailbox user now and there. I could try sending email from one to t'other, couldn't I? Should we quickly try that?
I think we should.
Okay, so let's do administrator to Shabby. Quickly on this one, because I realise you must be getting bored by now.
Who?
Them.
Well, I was going to say, I never get bored of you.
The others.
Others.
Lost his back, isn't that? Right.
How would you know that?
Shabby.
We're based out of the UK. Oh, a couple of good shows, actually, whilst he's just typing away an email. Studio 60, from the guys who did West Wing. I believe that's a new American show, so I'm looking forward to that coming to the UK. And The Wire. Something which we never received over here, but I'm hoping that maybe one day we'll come to the UK.
There was a program last night, you see, on More 4, about... It was weird, it was like a docudrama about George W. Bush being assassinated. And it was like, what happened, but it was done with him, with archive footage, and I thought, it's a little bit weird to sort of dramatise being shot and everything.
I guess they're always looking to take TV to the extreme.
Yeah. Anyway, that mail's gone across. Let's... go back to Exchange 2007, because hopefully we can just move these mailboxes, decommission and wrap up. Presumably we can do multiple select, yeah. And let's do move user.
Remove?
Where's move?
Oh, yeah, move mailbox. I was going to say, you don't want to remove them.
Jeez.
I love the way that for the past 3 hours that hard drive has just been thrashing away.
Yeah, it really has met its limit, hasn't it? Mm. Well, this is a beta, so again, betas are quite resource hungry a lot of the time because they have, well, sometimes they have debug code in still.
Well, we read this required a gig of RAM to run.
It's got 384. That's mad, isn't it?
Okay, so people, well, that's probably quite useful for people to know that we actually managed to get this running under 384 meg of RAM. Because one blog that I read, the guy said that it required a minimum of 1 gig.
Yeah, on the mailbox is quite. What was it?
7 meg and
it was 2 gig minimum, wasn't it?
Plus 7 meg in the mailbox. Now, if you've got four mailboxes, that's another 21 meg you're going to have to find.
It's all about caching, because when you look at exchange servers, you know, that's supporting loads of users, the bottleneck is always I.O.
Sure.
It always is I.O. The process is nothing now. You know, sometimes when you click on Outlook and you open up the inbox, and it takes a while. It's just I.O. on the exchange server, causing that. Well, no, because that's because you're a really small, almost pathetic organisation.
Yeah, you just endear the users to you.
I know.
The viewers.
Right, so that's all done, that's all finished.
So right, well, we're waiting for this to now change from being...
This is an MMC we're using.
Yeah.
We can't expect it to all
loading.
Refresh.
Yeah, I think we can.
And oh, Jesus Christ.
It auto-refreshed. Do you want to just acknowledge that auto-refreshed?
I pressed F5, actually.
But it auto-refreshed for Shabby.
I pressed F5 then. I'm lying, I didn't press F5 in any situation.
So MMC's now auto-refresh. That's good.
That's good. It? Right, I don't really know what else I need to do. Should we try and decommission the other exchange service?
Well, we're trying to cram into 45 minutes.
Well, maybe we can just have a quick read. Are we in any? Because I think this is good stuff, isn't it?
It is.
Because I was in a really good help file a minute ago. Right, planning for deployment. Upgrading.
Yeah, because if it looks nice, Bob will suggest that we have to migrate to this.
There's got to be some reason to upgrade to the thing, isn't there? Right. So migrating from Exchange, no, we don't want to do that.
So there's no, just to get this right, for 2007 there's going to be no in-place upgrading then?
It doesn't look that way, no. Again...
So not only do you have to buy Exchange 2007, you have to buy a server as well.
Well, I think the server that you're running your previous version on probably wouldn't be man enough to run 2007 anyway, so I think you need to buy additional hardware.
Right, okay.
Right, procedure. So I've done that. I've done a typical installation. Move mailboxes. If you want to remove Exchange 2003 servers, if there's any public folders... Create a replica on Exchange. Okay, so it looks like what we've got to do is if we had any public folders in 2003, create a replica in 2007, let it replicate, and then take it away. Now there's, is it PF Migrate? Well, the Exchange people will know that out there, that does the similar thing for migrating 5.5 to 2003.
Okay.
And that's just a VBS script. If you want to move, you must remove Exchange 2003 routing groups.
We haven't got any.
I have. So this is 2007, isn't it? Let me just see. Well, no, this doesn't... Actually, 2007 doesn't use routing groups.
No, that's my point.
Because routing groups control message flow. Within a routing group, your exchange servers go... go straight from source to destination. Between routing groups, you've got control. But now it's integrated with Active Directory sites, which makes a lot more sense.
Well done.
Yeah. Right, so quickly back into here. Let's go to Exchange.
See how it's found the connector shows that it's between the two.
Right, what I've got to do is just go to Action, Properties,
Large Icons,
and say Display Routing Groups. I'm going to go into Routing Groups here. And can I delete this? Was it telling me to delete it like this? Must move all members from the routing groups. So I don't see how I can take this out of a routing group.
We're about to find out.
Yeah. See, it's great because you're never about to do this on a live network, can you? Even on a...
Well, we are. You've got to remove the connectors before you can remove the members.
Can I just uninstall it?
I'm not sure.
Maybe that's tidying up afterwards. You just uninstall the fuck. Well, presumably what you probably could have done, and what I should have tried to do is... I don't know if that would have worked. Because when you're migrating 5.5 to 2000 or 2003, what you do is you switch the 5.5 servers off, and then you can delete them.
Right.
You might be capturing this, so you might have to rewind and capture that. What I did... is I just went in. I'm just randomly trying things now. So I've gone to Exchange 2000 and 3 admin console, and I've just gone to the server object and deleted it. So you would have seen that happen because it's still capturing, isn't it? Now I'm going to try and remove this bugger again and see what happens.
So are we
because there's nothing in the routing groups anymore.
Are we talking at this?
Yeah,
point?
Yeah. This has been captured, mate.
Oh, crikey!
So I'm removing. Remove and let's see if we get an error again. Oh look. There you go, that's stopping the service. So it looks like we upgraded with pure guesswork almost.
So it just goes to show you don't even need to know what the fuck you're talking about.
Nope.
You just prod until such times as something either moves or breaks.
Well, while that's uninstalling, what we can do is, I suppose, go back to 2007 have a look at web access.
Yeah, I was going to say, let's have a look at the web front end. Which one are you trying to web access from?
The actual Exchange 2000, this one.
Oh, onto itself.
Yeah. Again, I think what's happening now is the Exchange 2000 installation. Oh, no. It wants the...
Exchange CD.
Mm.
To uninstall.
Yeah.
To remove stuff, it needs to install stuff. That's just so... That drives me crazy. We went through a period, actually, with Microsoft products where it constantly prompted you to put a sodding CD in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right, it's worth pointing out that during the installation, the installation's failed a little bit.
Mm. Of what?
The uninstallation, yeah. Well, I'm just going to power that little thing off and see what happens.
What little thing?
This Exchange server.
Okay. And just boot it back up to prove that we are working on the new one.
No, just shut down Exchange, the Exchange 2000 server, 2003, and just see what happens.
Okay.
Yeah. So we deinstalled, well, I don't know if you've seen that bit, I'm not sure if that's going to be part of it, but just deinstalled deleted Exchange 2003 object from the Exchange 2003 System Manager,
yeah.
And then we can delete the routing group. Yeah. Then I've gone through the deinstallation of Exchange 2003, everything, you know, didn't go according to plan, not gonna lie. And yeah, there's a few errors that said I couldn't deinstall, there was some problems with some files. Now I'm not quite sure if maybe running the deinstall from the service pack in extracted service pack 2 might be the key for that.
Okay.
I don't know, but again, we're going to sort of wrap up now because the mailbox is working. Sorry. Yeah, go on.
I was going to say, does it really matter? Because we're only going to format that machine.
Well, exactly. What I'm going to do is, you can see now, I'm just going to shut the old Exchange server down and see what happens.
And prove that we're still running on the new one.
Well, yeah, exactly. It's not so much proving because I don't know if it is going to work. Because I wouldn't say this is an ideal way to do it. I was hoping to deinstall it cleanly, etc. Because
sure.
The trouble with the failure of the deinstallation is I'm not sure if it's cleaned up, you know, Active Directory.
Right.
And maybe the other one thinks it's still there. Who knows?
This is part and parcel of what we do for a living.
Incidentally, this is my client machine, just logging on as the administrator to the Exchange 2007 server.
Okay.
So I can show you that if I just go into Tools, Email Accounts, and say View or Change. One, so there's my Exchange server, let's quickly go to change, and you can see the new name is up there, so it's definitely working fine. The other thing just to note is I sent a couple of emails prior to that, and they're in my outbox, so that's got migrated across, that's kind of cool.
You haven't had anything come back saying it wasn't able to?
No, exactly, so that seems to be all fine.
They haven't replied to you, though?
No.
Are they not working at this time? They're
Well, yeah, sort of. What I'm going to do now is I'm just going to test out the web access. Look. The new Outlook web access. I've got no idea what the advantages are, apart from it looks nice.
It's blue.
And use the blind or low vision experience.
Are we blind?
Choose UK, it's picked up.
By the time I've compressed it all, it's fairly, fairly unreadable.
This is 800 by 600, isn't it? Yeah, that's that. Yeah.
Well, if it isn't, then you've ruined the whole podcast. It'd be fine.
When you click on OK, it's doing that bloody...
It's doing more. Right, so they basically made the bar blue.
Yeah, different colour. Documents. What's
dude,
this about?
It's almost identical.
You can use Windows to access SharePoint. Ah, okay, so they've integrated.
Ah, they've integrated SharePoint. Okay, because we were all wondering when this was going to happen.
Yeah, I remember them saying this version of Exchange wasn't actually going to support public folders. That it does. I know that for a fact now because they realised that would have been a stupid thing to do.
It wasn't. They weren't going to. Why? What was?
Well, I think they were trying to push people really heavily onto SharePoint. I think SharePoint is a good good product.
But if you don't need SharePoint, it's overkill. Although having said that, if you're going to be running this, you're probably running quite a large organization.
Well, if you've got 2007 in SharePoint, it just makes the whole thing easier. Mm. Maybe that's what we want.
Yeah. Okay.
Anyway, I'm bored. Let's go.
Yeah, I mean, we've got to the point. It's working. We got rid of the old one.
Yeah, so what we've seen, so we had Exchange 2003. We introduced 2007 into the organisation.
We were running both concurrently for a while.
Yep, running both concurrently for a while. Moved the mailboxes across. we could send mail to between users on the different exchange servers.
Exchanges.
I was amazed by that, because there was no settings.
We weren't getting any complaints from any users.
No, none whatsoever.
So we decided to then deprecate.
No, I think it should be fine, but I just hang up on that.
Yeah.
What else happened? And then we moved the mailboxes, went to the Exchange server, the Exchange 2003 server, with that system manager tool, deleted the object, tried to do an uninstall. Yeah. I'm not sure if this is the right way to do it, guys, but you know, it seemed to work quite well for us.
Worked for us.
Yeah, so tried to uninstall it, failed, so I just switched the thing off. And this seems to be working fine now.
Excellent.
So
I think based on that, we'll call it a day. I've been saving this till the end of this podcast, but I wanted to congratulate you on getting your all clear from the clinic. So, bye.
But you've done. Right, bye.
IT Idiots is sponsored by UK2.net, the UK's largest web hosting provider. With domains from just £1.99 and web hosting from just 40p a day, visit itidiots.uk2.net for weekly offers. Get your piece of the internet at uk2.net.
Well, that was also a good nasty. Bobby cried himself to sleep tonight on his huge pillow.